Claims of Identity by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 21 of 27. Sherman's March and Social Mating. In 1984, Ross McKelvey began filming what would later become an award-winning documentary, Sherman's March, 1986. Although originally intended to retrace the destructive campaign of Civil War General William Tecumseh Sherman, the film instead focuses on the author's personal psychological and geographical journey through the South in the search for a mate. For this reason, the film's complete title reads, Sherman's March, a meditation on the possibility of romantic love in the South during an era of nuclear weapons proliferation. McKelvey considers the title absurd, but one which aptly sums up the major themes of the film. These include nuclear holocaust, kinship networks, social dating customs, and mate selection. The purpose of this essay is to analyze the major concerns of the director as they relate to the autobiographical nature of his film. This essay will also focus on the similarity between Sherman's March and McKelvey's own movement as an unmarried adult in search of lasting romance. The film begins in a manner characteristic of the whole. It is to mention historical accounts of Sherman, then immediately switch gears and focus on McKelvey's own personal dilemmas. 2 years ago, he begins, I was about to shoot a film about the lingering effects of Sherman's march through the South. Anyway, I had just got a grant to make my film and I stopped by in New York to spend a few days with a woman I'd been seeing. The use of anyway here is significant because it relays an important mechanism of McKelvey's that he uses through the rest of the film. It helps him to create a connection between the film he is supposed to be shooting and the personal tangents he considers, which make up the bulk of the film. It is a rhetorical device used to pivot. Faced with the realization that he has never had a lasting romantic engagement, Ross takes this beginning portion of the film to acquaint the viewer with his situation as an aging, unmarried adult, and he does so with a sense of urgency to find himself a mate. He is tired of short-lived romances. According to the advice others, such as his sister, Ross should clean up his appearance, perhaps even shave his beard so as to attract women, so you at least have a choice in the matter. Ross' dawning realization at the beginning of the film is that, as old as he is, in his early 30s, he is not in a secure position of being happily married. He doesn't want to remain single. Even if he is not explicitly married, he at least desires a lasting romance. It is his primary concern in the film, whereas he hadn't apparently given it much consideration before. This fear of being alone, says John Hall in Divine Madness, seduces us into confrontation with some of the deepest conflicts in our lives, such as the decision to get married, 225. When Ross reaches Atlanta with a girl named Pat early in the film, he evinces a strong need to contemplate his situation and find out what he wants to do, both romantically and cinematically. He discerns the emotional direction the film is taking, and he must question whether to focus on Sherman's march or his own romantic journey through the lives of seven women eventually met along the way. It is a highly self-reflective moment that Ross later likens to looking into a mirror and trying to see what you look like when you're not really looking at your own reflection. This moment also draws historical comparisons between Ross and General Sherman. Ross' time spent in Atlanta is in fact quite similar to Sherman's own objective in lingering there during an overall campaign toward the sea. As N. Bailey notes in The Chessboard of War, during that time Sherman carefully pondered his options, 48. However, as with Sherman, Ross, too, feels the sinking realization that he cannot stay. From the day Sherman rode into Atlanta, he knew he could not be there indefinitely. Feeding his army required huge quantities of provisions, and any disruption along the railroad was a nuisance, 48-49. In the case of Ross, his army and his provisions are financial in nature. He is not a wealthy filmmaker, and the scarcity of film stock for him to shoot with is a continual concern. This is one reason for Ross' unhappiness. However, much more of Ross' anxiety and despondency in the film appears directly linked to fears of being alone. This is partly, but probably not primarily, due to social stigmas about individuals who never marry. The idea is likely that they are bored with their lives and extremely discontented. Peter J. Stein in Single Life explains Ross feelings as part of an age 30 transition. He writes the following report. For many, the years between 28 and 32 involve considerable turmoil, confusion, and struggle with societal pressures, with family, and with oneself. For others, these years involve a quieter re-evaluation of goals and values and an intensification of efforts to achieve such goals. Many men and women who remain single into their 30s report that the middle to late 20s was a period of great difficulty. 14. Most possibly, the age 30 transition is what is responsible for the growing disappointment and unease described during the personal segments of Sherman's March. This also has a great deal to do with the rapidity of Ross' dreams about thermonuclear annihilation. I usually don't dream of nuclear war, he explains, but when things go bad with my love life, the war dreams start up again, and missiles take to the sky by the thousands. A startling connection between Ross' sense of impending doom and his romantic failures appears in great measure to be the integrated psychology of nuclearism. As Richard Falk and Robert Lipton note in Indefensible Weapons, the central existential fact of the nuclear age is vulnerability, 23. Hence, senses of vulnerability and insecurity in relationships have a great factor with war dreams. Falk and Lipton go on to detail, psychologically, security means feeling safe, experiencing one's environment as reliable and, generally speaking, life-enhancing, but that sense of security is never total regarding weapons of mass destruction, 23-24. Amid fears of nuclear annihilation, a vigorous security is obviously lacking in Ross' mindset. He cannot feel happy or safe because he has a strong worry of being alone and remaining unsettled. Contentment is replaced by regret of past failures with women and frustration. The concept of vulnerability is therefore a strong motive in Ross's attempt to meet women, and unconsciously, to get married and settle down into some routine involving emotional and financial security. His worry that he will never have enough money, as a poor filmmaker, also adds to his discontentment. A psychological study in Peter Stein's Single Life, in fact, gives this explanation. Among the late marrieds, the timing of events is far more important than the events themselves. Men married when they felt particularly vulnerable and/or were encouraged by a significant other, in this case, Ross's family members and friends. Most of the late marrieds had short courtships, they were ready for marriage and did not want to lose the opportunity when one developed. 14. As the film shows, Ross' relationship with Deed is rushed. Ross' friend, Charlene, even states that she wants to see them married by Christmas. It is early fall when she says so. The idea that getting married will cure Ross' unhappiness is also validated by a report in The Consequences of Being Single, which states that, in fact, numerous studies have shown that men with spouses are more likely to enjoy psychological well-being than unmarried adults, 30. It can be difficult to find a good mate, and Sherman's March is a good meditation on that difficulty. Much of Ross's despair and introspection is a direct result of this. As is described elsewhere in The Consequences of Being Single, the pressure to conform, to get married, is so intense in North American culture that it is a rare individual who does not internalize it, Reisman 1964. The internalization of social pressures such as these undoubtedly induces a proclivity for distorted self-questioning, especially when marriage is viewed as the principal standard for validating personal adequacy and heterosexual normalcy. 42-43. Although social pressure in contemporary society in this regard is in many ways inverse to what it was in the 1960s, now veering toward favor of perpetual singleness, there must be a biological or spiritual basis for traditional sentiments because, as the author can attest, they are a continual inner drive, yet mitigated by contrary social pressures of the world. At a certain point in the film, Ross begins to feel some things in common with General Sherman and points out several similarities between himself and the historical figure. Physically, in particular, they are remarkably alike. According to George Nichols' literary portrait in The Story of the Great March, General Sherman is nearly 6 feet in height, with a wiry, not ungraceful frame. His beard and mustache, of a sandy hue, are also closely cut. His constitution is iron, 120 to 121. This physical description matches Ross quite uniquely, especially in regard to his beard, which becomes a topic of discussion throughout the film. It is a topic of some debate as to his sister's earlier advice that, to attract more women, he might consider trimming it, or doing away with it entirely. In terms of psychology, Ross feels a strong resonance with Sherman, as well. I think Sherman went on his military campaign to prove to the world that he wasn't a failure, Ross states. Before the Civil War he had failed at everything he did. He was somewhat a laughing stock. The Civil War gave him a chance to prove himself. Implicitly, Ross must feel a great sense of failure wearing on him to connect with Sherman in this way, remarking on a physical resemblance and then interpreting keen psychological elements. Ross' self-doubt could be considered his own Civil War. This idea is strengthened when Ross mentions in a paroxysm of self-loathing and pity that he considers his entire trip through the South to be an enormous romantic failure. Yet, despite Ross's marauding feeling of romantic failure, he rarely channels his frustration onto others. He tends, oppositely, either to internalize it or, in a healthier manner, sublimate it into his art. Undoubtedly, much of his sexual tension was transferred into the making of this film. Only on the occasion of staying with Karen, an old friend he had never had a romantic engagement with, but with whom he had gone at great lengths to visit numerous times, as vice versa she herself had done, does Ross mention to the audience that he is upset that every time he visits her she gets back together with her ex-boyfriend. Ross feels jealous at this point. He knows that he is jealous, but I can't stop from feeling that way. Instead of spending his time on what could otherwise be useful enterprises, he cannot help but ask Karen why they never had a romantic involvement. However, his quandary leads him no closer to her heart, and she simply apologizes if she led him on. Ross, frustrated, continues to film her while asking her similar lines of questioning. The result is an emotionally destructive conversation that goes nowhere. It may be significant that only a few miles from Karen's home is Bentonville, where Sherman fought the last battle of the Civil War, and this is also where Ross comes to terms with his Southern Odyssey, the cinematic conquests, and the romantic struggle he has documented. It is the conclusion of his trip through the South. According to Rebecca Cutter in When Opposites Attract, Ross' tactics for conversing with Karen about a romantic relationship were tactless. Relationships are fragile and require protection from certain harmful elements, she writes. One of these is the past. When two partners are in dialogue, it is important to stay current and to resist dragging in elements from a former life in order to make a point. The future is also a barrier, 55. Ross' admittedly bad handling of his discussion with Karen, thus, appears to be a result of his internal difficulties and processes converging and coming to a climax, superheated and exploding as volcanoes. Among the more interesting aspects of the film, though, is the way Ross utilizes his camera as a way of meeting women. His regard as an eligible bachelor is complemented by the willingness of the women he meets to flirt with the camera. The camera might have some allure for women eager for attention, and the validation it brings, such as Pat, but it is also a great conversation piece, as his sister says, "See, you have an instant rapport with people because you have a camera." It may contribute a layer of mystique or influence to Ross that women seem drawn to. In addition, since women are more likely to flirt with Ross because of his camera, there is an elevated level of sexual interest according to several nonverbal cues one witnesses through the film. Psychological studies also place great significance on a woman's nonverbal cues, as Pamela Kalbfleisch notes in Interpersonal Communication. The perceptions and attributes of seductiveness are commonly found when flirting, including distance, eye contact, touch, and clothing. Much of this research confirms that males are more likely to perceive the interaction in sexual terms than females, however, 16. In this regard, One of the more salient and humorous moments of the film is Ross' intensively self-reflective narrative pondering how he should have responded to Pat's remark that she wasn't wearing any underwear. This evidently sexual cue, in fact, keeps him up through the entire night. It illustrates a man's tendency to view such a statement in a sexual manner. It's not like telling someone you're not wearing any socks, he notes. The conclusion of the film does not end on a despairing note, however. Instead, it is one of hope and anticipation. Although Ross doesn't have a Sherman-esque conclusion where he wins the war, he does find a new romantic interest that ends with a positive outlook as the film concludes, suggesting hope. It might also be important to note that Sherman's conquest of the South was not as satisfying as it might appear. Immediately following the war, Sherman was reviled by Southerners for his destructiveness, and by his Northern compatriots rebuked for inefficiency. Work cited. Ostrom, Douglas R. The Consequences of Being Single. New York, Peter Lang, 1984. Print. Bailey, N.J. The Chessboard of War. Lincoln, University of Nebraska Press, 2000. Print. Cutter, Rebecca. When Opposites Attract. New York, Dutton, 1994. Print. Falk, Richard and Robert J. Lipton. Indefensible Weapons. New York, Basic Books, 1991. Print. Kalbfleisch, Pamela J. Interpersonal Communication, Evolving Interpersonal Relationships. Hove, Lawrence Erlbaum Associates, 1993. Print. Nichols, George. The Story of the Great March. New York, Harper and Brothers, 1865. Print. Stein, Peter J. Single Life. New York, St. Martin's Press, 1981. Print.